So as we are joined by our audience from YouTube, I want to, with all my heart, welcome Shanti ji. Shanti ji.
Namaste.
Namaste. Hari Om.
Hari Om.
And welcome to this time and to this space. You know, when Deen Dayalan introduced your life to me and said, Deen Dayalan is a visiting professor at Soil. He is a absolutely wonderful person who works at the grassroots level with the blue-collared workers. His whole mission in life is to empower them. And when he told me about this remarkable friend he has, Dr. Shanti Ranganathan, and said that, you know, Anil, you must invite her to this Thursday series because she's such a remarkable person and her life is such a unique story about how somebody empowered herself. So we are so delighted that you are here, and I'm now going to also start the webinar so that it's 6:30. We can start welcoming our guests who have registered for this webinar into the room.
They will
slowly start coming into the room. Some of them are our students, some of them are our alumni, some of them are working in industry, some are in the social sector. So welcome everybody to meet once again a remarkable virtuous leader. And Shanti ji, thank you very much for coming to this program. Thank you. Thank you very much. I also want to introduce the prodigal son of Soil, Jaswant. So he is right from the beginning of when Soil started. So Jaswant, would you please introduce yourself?
Yeah. Thank you so much, Anil. And I'm quite humbled to be amongst in this platform where I have a Padma Shri as well as Anil along with me. So I'm quite humbled to be amongst both of you. Not really a very brief introduction amongst you people, but nevertheless, like he said, I'm son of Soil. So I was born in Bangalore, raised in Tamil Nadu for some time, and did my engineering from Amrita School of Engineering in Coimbatore. And worked for SR Group in the steel business almost for 3 years. And I wanted to do a one-year MBA. The reason why I selected Soil was one pure reason that it had a social innovation project. Soil was the pioneers in introducing that subject into the curriculum as a mainstream curriculum. So I was very impressed on the way it was integrated as part of the curriculum. So that drew me towards the school. And then the life changed. I got placed in Mahindra, worked there for 3.5 years, then went on to work with MRF Tires. And then now I'm presently heading learning and development, talent management and organization development for Kevin Care Group. So one of the best learning what I've learned from Soil is the art of knowing, doing and being, which I use in every session of mine, every change management session or any session of mine. I generally use that. I think that's one thing which has changed a lot in me. So that's one thing which I would proudly say. So thanks, Anil, for making me part of this whole story. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Shanti ji, you've had a remarkable life. And, tell us about your early days. You describe yourself, your family, your parents, and your childhood and your growing up. Can you share something with us about the early part of your life?
Okay. I'm from a very traditional, conservative, middle-class family. As a young girl, I had no big ambition or goal. To me, future is getting married, having children, take care of the household. While I was doing my final year graduation, TTK family approached my parents. My marriage was fixed. I would say I entered married life totally unprepared, having no idea about the kind of life I was going to lead there. There was absolutely no similarity in our backgrounds. Every single thing I encountered in the family posed some challenge or other for me. We speak Tamil at home, They spoke only in English. They had a lot of social events and then parties, which I was not used to. I've never seen anybody drinking in my life. There were a lot of new things which were happening when I got into the new family. The truth was, I had everything in my life. A loving husband, caring parents-in-law, a beautiful home. But somehow, I did not enjoy anything at all. And none of the comforts in the house could make me relax and happy. There was one person who was very, very caring, who went out of the way to make me comfortable. That was my mother-in-law, Padma. She was a very accomplished person. In total contrast, I was a young girl full of fear and anxiety. She showed me affection, concern, and taught me many things in life. She treated me like a daughter. At the time of Bangladesh War in 1971, there was an appeal in the Hindu newspaper asking for clothes, vessels, bed sheets, and many things. I don't know what made me go from house to house to collect a lot of these clothes and other things. Came back home, washed with the help of my helpers, packed, and sent to Calcutta. That was my first initiative on my own to respond to human sufferings. Till today, I don't know, as a shy, no exposure, go out of my way to go and collect things for unknown people like Bangladeshis. My mother-in-law noticed this trait in me. She made me join Madras School of Social Work. Whatever she said, I generally obey. I never questioned her. So when I joined the Madras School of Social Work, the first time I was asked to introduce myself, I could say only two words. I'm Shanti, I am married. They asked me, what made you join this course? I said, no, my mother-in-law wanted me to join the course. That's what I've joined. I had no goal, clue, and I had no children. So it's one way of keeping me occupied. That's how I looked at it at that point in time. But Madras School of Social Work, 2 years, helped me to blossom. I was able to learn many skills. I was exposed to the outside world. It was a great learning for me, those 2 years.
How very nice. You know, you talked about the 1971 war, and I'm reminded of my time. I was in Pune. My father was in the army. My both sisters married army officers. My elder brother was in the army. My cousin was in the army. They were all at war. And, you know, we wanted to do something. So I wrote a play in Hindi for the first time and went and requested Film Institute people to come and act.
Ooh.
And in the Officers Institute in Dehu Road, the small place in near Pune, they came and performed. We sold tickets at 5 rupees a ticket. And, you know, we collected 5,000 rupees and donated to the Army Wives Welfare Association. And just like you said that, you know, you did that. And I suddenly discovered doing something for others is such a joyful activity. You know, so I was just reminded of that. So thank you for sharing your memory of the 71 war. Now tell us about your husband, and tell us as to, you know, as you described to me, he used to drink, and tell us about that whole problem, and tell us about this whole alcohol issue that that you found with your husband. Yeah.
Okay. After completing my 2 year in post-graduation, an aunt of mine developed jaundice after taking blood from a professional donor. So I want to do something on this issue. I started the first voluntary blood bank in this part of southern India. I used to go to industries, offices, colleges, talk about the importance of voluntary blood donation. And I used to organize camps in industries, offices, and collect blood there. So I gained a lot of confidence. I gained a lot of strength. My blood bank was doing extremely well. But unfortunately, my marital life was going in a different direction. My husband started drinking. He was an affectionate, generous person, but I was troubled by his drinking. I didn't know what to do to stop his drinking. Whenever I faced any problem, I knew only one way, to pray. I do a lot of fasting, visiting temples, but nothing helped. There was no help, there was no rehab centers in the entire country. Not only in India, in the neighboring countries also. This was in 1979, almost 40 years back. A cousin of my husband mentioned that treatment is available in Seattle. So we took my husband to America. He underwent training, he underwent treatment. While he was in treatment, I underwent family therapy program. That was the first time I knew that addiction to alcohol is a disease like any other. An alcoholic has to quit alcohol completely. It's also important the family also has to get back to a normal life. I learned this while I was undergoing family therapy. Unfortunately, we came back. After a few months, he had a relapse. Within a short period of 4 or 5 days, he had acute pancreatitis and he died. He was 33 in 1979. And after his death, I don't know what made me make the decision. In 1980, February itself, we registered the society to start a treatment center for alcoholism. My mother-in-law did not want to hide the fact that her son died of alcoholism. She said she was not ashamed of him. So unless we are open about it, it would not be able to do anything about it. Hence, we named the organization on my husband's name, TT Ranganathan Clinical Research Foundation. Later, it became TTK Hospital. So we started a center in 1980s. Hardly 4 months after his death. Again, I went to America for 4 months training. My sister accompanied me. So I stayed there for 4 months in USA, underwent training on alcoholism, came back, started an outpatient care in our own home and provided treatment. At some point in time, large number of patients were coming from all over India. There was a need to build a completely full-fledged center. So in 1987, we built a 75-bed treatment center exclusively for alcoholism. That was the first center in the entire country to treat alcoholism.
How very nice. You know, you converted a personal tragedy into doing something positive for society. You know, this requires lots of blessings that, you know, because a lot of people in your place would have said, why is life very unfair to me? Why has this tragedy come to me? And many people start having self-pity and self-doubts and go into, you know, different negative emotional states. But you chose to make this particular aspect that happened to you, instead of saying, why has this happened to me? You said, okay, now what do I do with my life? And how do I help others not to suffer? This aspect, where did this come from, Shantiji? Can you describe to us that moment and how did this idea of inspirational idea strike you?
To see this myself in a different perspective, to me, this work has given a meaning in life. Otherwise, no husband, no children, young age. What do I look forward to? To me, I see it in a different perspective. To me, this work has given a meaning in life. Every night when I go back to go to sleep, I feel fulfilled. I have no regrets. I have no resentment. I am happy. God has given me. I had plenty of blessings. Blessing from God, blessing from my people around me. When I started the center, the medical field did not really accepted our treatment module. Because to them, how can non-medical people treat alcoholism? all over the world, counselors are the ones who are treating alcoholics. And an alcoholic can never recover individually. He can recover only as a group. That's why the Alcoholic Anonymous program is very popular. So there was a lot of, you know, there was a lot of non-cooperation in the medical field, but we overcame it. And then when we started the center, patients trusted us. Industries referred patients to us, like Ashok Leyland, TVS Group. They referred patients to us. It's a blessing. And when I started the center, the first staff, Raymond, was a PhD from NIMHANS. She was willing to trust, which was actually an unknown organization. She joined us. All these are blessings. The lovely staff I had, the people who believed in us and came for treatment, all of them are, to me, blessings. I had blessing in plenty. I always tell, God wanted to compensate me. I wanted a husband and a children. He could not give it to me. He always overcompensated me. Whatever I wanted in life, God gave it to me. What I wanted to start an aftercare center, I was able to start it. I wanted to start a separate relapse ward, I was able to do it. I wanted to do something for the family, I was able to do it. At every point in time, plenty of God blessings and people around me.
Oh, very nice. Shantiji, describe to us the journey, because what began as a small outpatient department then became a full treatment center and then its institutionalization. So it almost became like a role model for the entire country. Can you describe to us the whole process of building this movement and this organization?
Okay. Initially, it was in our own home, a big home. So we started as an outpatient program. Patient would stay outside. They would get detoxified in a hospital and stay there the entire day. Even then, we had a program for the family. I could see all the time the suffering of the family, the guilt in them, the anger in them, resentment in them. So from the beginning, we had a separate program for the family members. What do we tell the family members? It's a disease. You are not responsible for his drinking. It is important you become functional. Many times the family also become dysfunctional because of his drinking, not able to take care of them, not able to take care of the children. Even things we take for granted like eating, sleeping, laughing, all are lost to the family. So in the family therapy program, we empower them. You have a right to live. Take care of yourself. Become functional. Take care of yourself as well as the family. So we started the outpatient program. We started the program for the family therapy. And then heroin addiction became an issue in 1989. Then we started an aftercare center, long-term health for the patients. Then when we keep seeing relapse patients, we start another program for the relapse patients. As I mentioned to you earlier, when I visited Manjakudi, the teachers were anguished. There are many children who are sleeping in the doorstep because the father had driven them in the night. Can you do something about our student's father? So with which made us, the entire team sat together, developed a community model. A community model which can be taken to the villages at the doorsteps. We have the treatment program either in a school or in a marriage hall or in a community center. We make use of the community support. We make use of the local doctor. We've been doing it in many other villages also. So we developed this community model of treatment. And this has been taken by the Ministry of Welfare as well as Ministry of Social Justice as well as by even ODC. Wherever the treatment centers are not available, they are using this community model of treatment. For like Afghanistan, Cambodia, we have trained the doctors. So they in turn, they are providing this community care of treatment in the villages. And what else we did? Then we also found that Government of India started many centers, but none of them had no proper clue on how to treat the patients. We developed something called the minimum standards of care. Today is the legal document by the Government of India. This is followed with all the centers. This is one way by complying with minimum standards of care, the Government of India's funding is provided to them. So from doing locally, then we started nationally, we contributed. Then internationally also for organizations like UNODC, Colombo Plan, we contributed, developed many manuals so that for the professional as well as the others.
Fantastic. Shantiji, this particular aspect of creating a movement, I'm curious to know that it's almost a taboo subject that, you know, for a family to first of all admit that we have a problem, that we have an alcoholic at home, and then to convince the person that he requires treatment, because mostly these are men who drink, right? And it's mostly the women and the children who suffer, right? So for a person who drinks and who's therefore not in his senses, to convince that person that he requires treatment like any other disease, and then to get the family to develop the courage not to have shame, how does that process work?
It was a marathon task in the initial stages. Yes. We used to visit all the industries, offices, and then create awareness. And there was AA, Alcoholic Anonymous, was non-existent at that point in time. In 1980, it wasn't there. Only in Bombay, few meetings were conducted. Once our patients were treated, they initiated AA meetings all over India. So AA also was behind us to create that awareness. AA members would go and talk to an alcoholic and motivate him. I was an alcoholic. I took treatment. I'm in AA. I have recovered. Mainly our ambassadors are recovering users. Nobody else. Well, there's a very interesting issue in our treatment center, in almost all the treatment centers. An alcoholic will celebrate his birthday the day they give up alcohol as the birthday. First birthday, wow. Second birthday. So we give them all we give them a medal. They come and share how they have given up and how they have achieved, what have they achieved the last 1 year or 2 years or 3 years. So by sharing their experiences, it is also breaks down. I don't have to be ashamed. Yeah, I see so many people who have recovered, who are doing well. It's also another motivating factor for the patients.
Very nice. Now tell me, this is something that might interest a lot of other people. You know, I used to also drink alcohol at one time and then I gave it up. Of course, it was never, it was always within limits. And something happened to me because of which there was an inner desire to say, there is no need for the stimulation anymore. But there are a lot of people, highly educated people, who begin to enjoy alcohol and they begin to use that as an excuse for stress relief. And there is a very thin line between enjoying alcohol and actually becoming addicted to it, where you can't do without it. Because I have friends of mine, if they do not get alcohol in the evening, or if they are going out for a, let's say for a gathering or for you know, a group going out to see some new places or some new countries like we do. So some of our friends, if they don't have alcohol, they would not even join the trip. How does one make people understand that where this thin line between enjoying alcohol and becoming addicted to it? How do you help people to realize the difference?
Okay. Not all drinkers become alcoholics.
Yes.
If 100 people drink, 80% of them drink socially, it does not affect their life. 20% of them become addicted to alcohol. How do you define them? It is not by the amount of alcohol they drink. It is mainly, has it started affecting any one compartment in his life on a continuous basis? Is it affecting his work life, family life, or financial condition, physical health? In spite of the problem, if he continues to drink, he is going towards addiction. There is also two kinds of dependency. One is physical dependency. When there is no alcohol, some of them would have tremors. They won't be eat properly. They won't be able to sleep properly. That's the most interesting aspect is the psychological dependence. In the absence of alcohol, they are very restless, as you were mentioned now, very restless, agitated. They don't enjoy what they are doing. So the physical and psychological dependency is the one which makes them dependent on alcohol and an alcoholic, and they need to quit alcohol completely altering. There is no two way at all. They can quit alcohol, they cannot become a social drinker again. They have, the minute they drink, they again start abusing. There are a lot of symptoms are there. The first symptom is increased tolerance. That is, they need more of alcohol to get the same effect. Earlier, they were happy with one or two drinks. Now they want three, four. And there's an also another problem in their attitude of many people is, if you drink, get drunk. That's another attitudinal problem also many of the drinkers have. And then they also have blackouts. Blackout is they function normally. The next day morning, they cannot recollect part of it, what has happened. That's a, once in a way it happens, over a period of time, it happens regularly. Then there is preoccupation with drinking. When drinking is not, as you said, in the sub party, there's no drinking. They avoid it. They don't like it. They crib about it. And any conversation about alcohol the family talks about, they get very upset.
Yeah.
These are the early symptoms.
Thank you for enlightening us on this. And all the people who are listening to this program and will watch it need to be more aware of it, as to how being fond of alcohol can always turn to something more serious. And I'm really amazed to know that 20% of the people who drink could become alcoholics. That's a very serious issue.
And there now, was a,
yes,
there was a study done in India, and you'll be shocked, 5.7 crores problem drinkers in India. This was a national survey. It was done in 2019. 2.9 crore dependency on alcohol.
My God.
Of the drinkers, 20% become dependents. 30 to 40% of them are problem drinkers. They may give up. Many of them, it's very common for them to go to Sabarimalai. They quit alcohol for 40 days. 41st day, they start drinking. They start drinking with vengeance. They always say, I have control. It is also part of the symptoms of alcoholism.
Yeah.
They may stay away from alcohol, but they start drinking, they won't be able to control.
Shantiji, let me ask you one question, that in this entire movement that you are that you have been so blessed to be part of and to co-create with your fellow colleagues, what has been personally for you the biggest challenge you have faced in facilitating this movement, and how have you overcome that challenge?
Initially, the medical field were not coming forth to accept our treatment module. That was a big challenge. We had to educate medical professionals also. Over a period of time, we started treating even doctors who have problem with addiction. And then was a very specific incident of, we were having a camp in a place called Kanyakumari. And the first day, a man was very sick with a delirium. We were forced to admit him in the camp. We were very reluctant. On the first day itself, in the evening, he died. It was a huge challenge for us. We wanted to close the camp, go back. We were not very sure whether the other patients will continue, whether the family members will trust us. That was the first camp in Cape Comorin, the Kanyakumari. Next day morning, when we were really ambivalent what to do, the wife of the patient came out and said, please do not go back. The families have come with lot of hope. Give them an opportunity. He pleaded with the alcoholics, I don't want you to die like my husband. Stay on. This is a lesson for you. That was a major challenge. But this challenge helped us to modify our camp program also. We became very strict with our selection procedure. And then we made many changes in our camp program so that it is foolproof.
Very nice. You know, you are doing also some remarkable work in this rural area, which you described, where you moved to, and where you have been doing some remarkable work in giving education to children and the schools that you run and the ITI that you run, so that as you have become older, more and more of your time has been spent into this rural setting. Can you describe this work and what you're doing here in the village?
5 years back, I retired from TTK work. I was working for almost 36, 37 years. I settled down in this village called Mandakudi, which is in Tiruvarur district in Tamil Nadu. My in-law supported a school there for the last 40 years. It is the birthplace of Swami Dayananda Saraswati. My parents-in-law were devotees of Swami Dayananda Saraswati. So I wanted to personally spend time here, more time for spiritual life as well as doing something for the school. So the school is almost 52 years old, first standard to 12th standard. It's a Tamil medium school. 1,400 children are there. I also noticed that there are children who find it very difficult to cope with regular education after the 8th and 9th. They drop out. They have no other occupation. Here, agriculture is done mechanically by machines. So they drop out. As a result, they go back. They start drinking. I wanted to make a change in their lifestyle. So we started ITI. This is for children who drop out the 8th standard, 9th standard, 10th standard. It is recognized by the Skill India. We offer 10 trades like welding, wireman, electrician, civil draftsman, plumbing. So they not only get the skill in their hand, they also get back their confidence. When they don't do well, people call them, you are useless, you are no good, you can't even pass A standard. So when they come here, they learn the skill and they get back their confidence. And we also make sure they all get jobs. We also organize through TTK connections, we organize job placements here, campus interviews are held, and they are placed in industries.
Very nice. What a remarkable piece of work that you are actually starting young so that they can be given the right kind of education. You know, so I think, Jaswant, it's time for you to begin by asking a question which you may want to ask from your own, and then start reading the questions from the Q&A box and the chat box that are there. So go ahead.
Great, Anil. Thank you so much, Anil. And I've got a question to you, ma'am. So the question is, in one of the news clippings, I did read that apart from you, thanking people, people thanking you for doing something in their life, you said that, they've healed me as well. That's a very, very broader statement, right? So
definitely.
Yeah. So what is that one story which really healed you a lot? There will be one moment in your life which really said, oh, am I doing so big? So what is that one moment in your life?
There are several moments, to tell you honestly. Husband and wife were being separated. They come back. They start living together. When we talk about that rehabilitation, we not only talk about giving up alcohol, we also talk about improvement in the area of life, get back to closer relationship with the family, and then healthy recreational activities. And then, the family members coming together, husband and wife separated for 6 years, 7 years, 10 years, coming together after attending the family therapy. That's a great moment. And sometimes they would not have had a child for a long time. They come back with a child. That's a beautiful moment. And I have visited many homes where they had nothing at all. Now they built a home. So every moment, every time I see a recovering alcoholic who makes a progress, it's a great joy for me. It's a great joy for me.
Okay, thanks, ma'am. Another question from me. Now, you might be seeing a lot of states are now taking up to set up or, making alcohol selling into a government subsidy where they generate a lot of revenue out of it, right? So I think Tamil Nadu also runs its own alcohol selling centers. So that's one of the major revenue generating source for states. And I'm sure most of the states, if I've learned right and if I can tell rightly, I think even Chhattisgarh has adopted a similar strategy to make much more revenue from the states. So what is your thought on that, ma'am? So one side, it's more to do with revenue, and the other side, it's more to do something bad to the people across. So what do you say from this?
Prohibition is not an issue. Many of them are looking for prohibition as an issue to deal with the problem of alcoholism. It is not. WHO has recommended many issues, many suggestions. For example, reduce the number of outlets. Less number of outlets, less number of people are consuming it. Reduce drinking with reduced hours. Tamil Nadu government introduced opening the bar at opening the Taskmark shop at 12, so that you know all the village women would always say, let them open at 12 so that the men could go for work. At least half a day they would be able to work, come back with some money. So reduce drinking with reduced hours. Enforce the minimum age in drinking. Regulate driving under the influence of alcohol. That's also another lot of drunken driving driving accidents that happen because of drunken driving. So there are a lot many ways. Availability should be curtailed. The number of outlets should come down. And the hours of, it is not a ration shop. It should be open to 24 hours. It can open at 12 and close at 6. So the limited number of hours, the number of people would be, the consumption would be less. And the cost of alcohol could be high too, because it's not a necessary essential item. Let them pay for it. If they don't have the money, let them not drink. Other method by which you can control the consumption rather than introducing prohibition, which is never going to work.
Great. So I have one question from Mr. Ramaraju. The question is, please explain why, while everything is shattered and gloomy, how can one again gather internal strength and faculties to focus everything to the societal benefit at the same time, a society looking at us differently?
Actually, I did not start with the intention of societal benefit. It was much more for my own growth, for my own satisfaction, to find a meaning in my own life. I found it. It's the grace of God and also support of the family. Nothing else I could talk about. I have plenty of blessings. I don't know, have I answered you, Mr. Ramaraju?
Great. So the next question is from Mr. Ambujakshan Nair. So do tell us, ma'am, how do we overcome regrets that keep demonizing us within and also overcome other obsessions?
In Alcoholic Anonymous, as well as the treatment of alcoholism, we always say, don't ever talk about giving up alcohol or tobacco all your life. It's always one day at a time. This every morning, make a decision whether it is tobacco, alcohol, heroin, whatever it is, today I'm not going to take. Dealing with it on a one-day basis, it's not a big issue. End of the day, thank God, I've been away from alcohol for a day. One day at a time is the principle which has been used by AA, by all the treatment center, all the time. It works very well. And there is also a few principles which they say, halt, hunger, anger, loneliness, tiredness. All of them are lead to use and abuse of alcohol. Avoid them. As if you are hungry, fill up your stomach. If your stomach is full, you don't feel like drinking. So the simple method of avoiding drinking. And let go, let God. That's another beautiful AA principle. There are a lot of anger resentment which we hold on to it, which will not allow us to go forward. Let go, let God take care of them. We don't have to deal with them. The resentment is the one which is taking them again and again back to drinking. These are few methods, suggested by AA as well as the rehabilitation centers.
Great, ma'am. So the next question, is something a little different. Anonymous person has asked. So alcoholics enjoy music mostly. So what's there in your music therapy which brings the required change in them?
We don't have any specific therapy to deal with as part of our rehabilitation. We don't have any When they give up alcohol, they have to have some healthy recreational activities. We ask them to go into gym. That's a very important one. Some of them go into music. Some of them go into other ways of, serving people, helping other alcoholics. So it's very important for them. There is a few hours which there's a gap where they spend for alcohol. That has to be replaced with some other activity. Let them do whatever they want. Listening to music or gardening or helping other people, whatever it is, or on spiritual line, something has to fill the time so that there is no gap in their life.
Great, ma'am. So the next question is from Mr. Rakesh Jansi. So he's got two questions. One is, what is the incidence of relapse in persons once they've got rehabilitated? So I think I'll post the second question after this.
And, just to introduce Rakesh Jansi, he was also the president of TOIL, our institution, for a few years.
Okay.
Rakesh is president of SOS Children's Village in India.
Oh.
So he obviously has very large these villages where children and orphans live. And, you know, he runs many schools as well. So he is himself running a very large social organization. So that's his background. Yeah.
Roughly 45 to 50% of them recover. Maybe one or two minor relapses. One or two minor relapses of a day to get back to normalcy. Definitely 20 to 30% of them go back to full drinking. They don't come back to the fold at all. That's why in every treatment center, beside the 1 month treatment, there is also follow-up, which is given for a period of 5 years. As I mentioned earlier, recovery is just not quitting alcohol. Unless he makes changes in every area of his life, getting back to work with passion, spending a lot of time with the family and children, having a healthy recreation activities, unless he makes many changes in life, the recovery is not smooth sailing. So who are the people who relapse? People who continue to live the same life as they had earlier, continue to go for the drinking parties, continue to store alcohol at home, continue to talk about what is wrong in having alcohol once in a way. We always tell them dry drunks. They are dry, not drinking. Drunk is same attitude which they had earlier when they were drinking. No change in their attitude, no change in their behavior. So definitely 30% of them go back to drinking, never return to a normal life. But definitely 40 to 45% of them recover completely. Very interesting issue is, if one alcoholic gives up alcohol, four members are happy. The parents are able to lead a normal life. The wife is happy. The children are also happy. We also have a program for the children. We tell them, if your father or grandfather was an alcoholic, do not try alcohol, because there's a genetic component in it. Where children of alcoholics are more prone for alcoholism. It is beside learned behavior, it is also, there's a genetic aspect to it. So I think I'm diversified. I'm sorry. Relapse happens. Recovery has to happen. These are two sides of a coin. One side is recover. He has to get back to a normal life. Only then recovery happens. If you don't make any changes, attitude changes, quality of life doesn't improve, you go back to drinking.
Great. So the second question which Mr. Jinsi has asked us, what is your funding or revenue model? Is it totally dependent on the grants, or are there user charges also for that?
Okay. Initially, the entire building, everything was funded by TTK group companies. Later, many other funding agencies provided the funding to the capital expenditures were taken care of in many industries. The revenue expenditure, it is mainly we charge them. And we also free patient quota. So we also have free patients. All the camps are conducted free of charges. And all the awareness programs, all the training programs are also conducted free of charge. We charge the patients also.
Okay, so the next question is actually from Mr. Deenadayalan, who is also a person who... Yeah, exactly. So he's given up drinking, social drinking, because of you. So that's what he's told. So his question is, states like Tamil Nadu, from relaxation of prohibition to proliferation of TASMAC. So what's your view? I think it's quite in line with the question which I asked, if I'm not wrong.
Yeah. Availability has to be controlled. That's all. And then creating awareness about the people, and then let them have alternative way of finding fun and happiness. Alcohol is not the only way of having fun. That's the attitude has to be changed. Go for gym, you get the same high.
Great. So the next question is from Ms. Mamta Bhatt. So what are the strategies to address new form of addiction, like addiction for games, addiction for social media?
Okay. When I was active in GTK hospital, this was not an issue. The last few years, at least last 2-3 years, TTK is also addressing these issues. And the children are brought on a outpatient basis. They are provided counseling, tips, and also similar strategy of getting out of their problem. Now it is offered at TTK itself.
I think that
there's a question from one of the students on YouTube, which I will read out. Kashika Chavla is one of our students. She's asking, ma'am, what took you to go so deep into such a field and explore such a difficult and different area? I mean, was it just the tragedy that happened in your life? Or was there some other inner search which developed as a result of your education or something else? What made you go so deep into this field, she's asking.
Actually, if there was a center available in India, I would not have lost my husband. There was no centers, nothing was available. So initially, the personal tragedy made me do something about it. The second issue is, over a period of time, I developed a passion towards the cause. So actually, I did my PhD at the age of 50, Tufts University, on the community approach of treatment and the efficacy of the treatment. So initially, it's a personal tragedy and the support of my family who encouraged me to take up this work, which made me do this.
Incidentally, Rakesh Jinsi is saying that he was associated with Mr. T.T. Srinath, who is on the board of Chatnath Homes in Chennai.
Yes.
So Mr. Jinsi is a friend of his, yeah.
Yeah, so we have the next question from Ms. Lata Jagannathan. What are the programs which you offer for the children of alcoholics?
We use art as a therapy to bring out the emotions from the children. We take children as young as 8 years old. We have two groups. We have an adolescent group where we have to talk to them in a different way. The youngsters, they suffer a lot, but they can't express it. They want to learn. Sometimes they feel that they are responsible for the father's drinking. When they find a lot of fight between the father and the mother, some of them feel, am I responsible? I am giving a lot of trouble to my parents. That's why are they fighting? So the young children have to be given an opportunity to share. We use art as a therapy. I'm a trained art therapist, and we have few staff who are also trained in this field. So we use art as a therapy to make them express their feelings. And also for the older people, it is important for them to make them understand that don't drink for the adolescent. Because this alcohol is so common, the day they finish the 10th standard, 12th standard, they finish the exam, they go and get drunk. So it's very important for them. As long as you don't touch alcohol, fine with you. The minute you start drinking, you don't know whether you're going to stay as a social drinker or an alcoholic. So the clear message has to be told to this adolescent. Thank you, Lata, my sister-in-law.
Oh, very nice.
So we've got another question from Mr. Ambujakshan Nair. So his question is, drinking is considered to be macho. Where otherwise we are treated to be more like Amul babies. And the second question is, cinema also popularizes social drinking as a healthy get-together trait. So what is your take on this?
There are a lot of achievers, like Tatas, they don't drink. Why don't you take them as role models? These days, it was there at one point in time. It is changing now. Nobody, consider a man who gets drunk as a person to be invited to a party. It is changing. Definitely, people are not comfortable with people who abuse alcohol or create problem in a party. So it's a change. We have to, as an individual, every one of us have to make an effort to change that attitude.
You know, Sarvesh Satija from YouTube is asking a question. What to do when alcoholism gets associated with personality disorders like excessive aggression in their temperament and other personality issues?
Okay.
So how do you handle those issues?
These days, we definitely see 10 to 15% of our patients have other associated psychiatric problems. Some of them have personality disorder. Some of them have depression. It is also, it has to be dealt with together. We call it dual diagnosis. Both issues have to be dealt with together. Only then the person will recover. So it cannot be ignored. Many people think that once alcohol, he gives up alcohol, other issues will sort out. It's not so. If they have a psychiatric problem, it has to be treated.
You know, while others are thinking of questions, let me ask you a question, and I'm sure Jaswant may have a question of his own. My question to you is that, you know, Swami Dayanand Saraswati is a disciple of Swami Chinmayananda, and I met Swami Dayananda several times. He has come to our house when we were children. Now, this aspect of the spiritual dimension, which has always been in some part, a part of your life. This inner journey of the spiritual kind, how has that empowered you to be the kind of person that you are? And how has that helped others also to deal with life's challenges?
Oh, definitely. It played a major role in my life. Even when I was a young girl, my mother-in-law was attending the sessions of Chinmayananda. She would take me along. And then later with Dayananda Saraswati. This has made a major influence on my life, the way I look at life. And in turn, I've also given certain, my staff has also imbibed some of my values, which I've taken from them. Somewhere we communicate that to our patients also. It has a major influence on my life.
How very nice.
So I've got a question, ma'am. So, you know, this also being more of a medical field, what kind of advancements are happening in the, rehabilitation side, or for that matter, you know, medicine side with respect to alcoholism, de-addiction, ma'am? So what kind of advancements are happening? So is India pioneering in that, or which country in the world is actually pioneering in that, or which state of our, in ranking are we in, especially in India? Talking about our country.
In the treatment of alcoholism, the role of medicine is very minimal. The rehab part is the changing the personality, changing the attitude of the individual behavior is the most important thing. So there are right now many medications for some medication where you take alcohol and you take a medicine, disulfiram, and if you take alcohol, it produces severe reaction. We give this medicine to them. So one way of avoiding alcohol, it is taken one every day for a period of 1 or 2 years. Every morning they make one decision. Today I'm going to take this medicine so that I cannot take alcohol. Now there are medications for craving. To quit smoking, there are medications. So definitely everywhere, all over the world, the number of medicines which are available in this field is minimal. Because rehab is the most important issue in treating addiction.
Very nice. I think Deen Dayal is also saying something more in the chat, I think. Or no, Pradeep Malik is asking a question. Yeah, go ahead. Pradeep Malik, former chairman of Attila, a coach to senior leaders and a dear friend.
Yeah, so...
okay, I didn't read what he wrote subsequently, but go ahead, read it, yeah.
Yeah, so it's more of a comment saying, make people like Anil Sachdev and other high achievers as role models.
I'm not sure if I'm a role model, but, my brother, Colonel Rakesh Sachdeva, is also on this call. We all four brothers used to drink. We never allowed, of course, alcohol to drink us. We used to drink alcohol. But with the grace of God and I think my mother's and father's blessings, all of us gave up alcohol at a reasonably young age, and especially for my brother being in the army. So I know a lot of people who have had alcohol at some stage of their life, and at some other stage they decided they no longer needed it. And there are others who just are the occasional light wine and beer drinkers who continue with that in a very moderate way for the whole life. And, you know, that's fine too. So I think what Swami Chinmayananda, I remember, once there was this great party done in a devotee's house, and there was a well-known actress of those days, Munmun Sen, who was drinking and smoking and standing next to Gurudev. And I was at that party and I was getting very uncomfortable. And I said, you know, Gurudev noticed me and said, why are you being uncomfortable? I said, Gurudev, for them to behave like this and to call you in their party. So he said, it is not your problem. It is their problem. And then he said, you know, remember, as long as you drink alcohol, it is fine. Don't allow alcohol to drink you. So that was a very interesting, and he laughed heartily like he always did. So very interesting about how, you know, the concept of role model could be talked about. But, you know, one last question, which is on behalf of the audience, I ask this question to you, and maybe then Jaswant can sum up what he learned from you this evening. You know, it takes a whole lifetime for you to do something like this. And you must have done specially conscious institution building and developed a second line of leadership who was able to replace you so that you could then do this work on the schools. So what were the things you consciously did to develop the institution so that it was no longer dependent upon you?
I don't know whether I did it consciously. A cousin of mine was working with me. She was willing to take over the institution, and she has taken over. Many of the staff members have been working with us for a very long time. They in turn trained the juniors. It goes on. That's all I could say.
How very nice. How very nice.
And we have a very beautiful prayer in our Alcoholic Anonymous. God, grant us the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. So that's a beautiful prayer of Alcoholic Anonymous. I can only change myself. I cannot change the world. Do whatever I can. Give them an opportunity to change.
Okay. I think Jaswant, Krishna Raj, one quick answer he requires on one last question in the chat box.
Yeah, so the question is female generation. So the present generation females are also consuming a lot of alcohol as part of social status. The trend is increasing phenomenally. What's your thought on that now?
It is increasing, but it is not alarming. The national survey conducted recently also reflected the same thing. Even now, there are a lot of pressure, social pressure is there for women. If they drink, there's a pressure on them. So not many of them do drink. So right now, we don't have, it's not an alarm issues, but definitely it is on the increase. But there are no women-centered treatment centers in India. Even if they have a problem, women don't come out because they don't get the support of their alcoholic husband or alcoholic other family members to get them into treatment. So if the woman has a problem, she doesn't get any support, she's not taken for treatment. So that's also another issue. And there are no women-centered centers in India. That's another problem we have.
Yeah. Dr. T.V. Rao, the wonderful, the father of the human resource movement in the country, he is there. He had visited your center. He's also written about you in his book. Right. So he's complimenting you and remembering his visit. He's also in the program today. So Jaswant, do you want to sum up what you learned this evening?
Yeah, so one great learning from you, Shanti ma'am, is that, you know, how we can really turn problems into an opportunity because of our inner strength and also because of our inner desire to do something different for the you know, people across us. So that's one thing which I learned. And of course, the second thing which quite aligns with the principle of soil is, like I said at the beginning, you know, it's more for us. We all live for, you know, not only for knowing and doing, we also live for being. So you are an epitome of being, and you know, you are yet another inspiration for me to you know, start being in my life rather than only knowing and doing. I think these are the two great learnings from my from this session, man. Thank you so much.
Thank you,
Shantiji. Here are the five things I learned from you this evening. Number one, you honored your family. You honored the fact that you were brought up in a conservative culture, and you also honored the family of your husband. The rapport that you built with your mother-in-law and the gratitude that you have shown to her right through from the first day I talked to you. What a story of inspiration in India for mother-in-law, daughter-in-law to become friends, for you to acknowledge that and for you to have that gratitude. I think this is a wonderful example of that. Second, you... right from the first time I talked to you a few weeks back to again in the story today, you never criticized or put down your husband. You did criticize his action, but not the person. You were always saying he was a loving husband. He wanted to get changed. So you were very sensitive. You were not putting down the person, but you were only reviewing the action. In that, there is a hope that action can be transformed. And the person, the goodness is there. The third aspect you said, you care to listen to the inner voice. When the 1971 war broke and you saw that advertisement asking for help, something from inside you guided you and you chose to listen to it. A lot of us do not pay attention to the inner voice. You chose to listen to your inner voice. And that is something which can guide us all our life. Number four, you made the cause the reason of the purpose of your life. You understood that the cause gives you the power. That gives you the blessing. When you serve the cause, leadership happens to you. And you know, when you go to sleep in the night, you said you had a full life because you said, I have done my best to serve people, and that is all that matters. Number five, in all your stories, you very willingly learned from, for example, my favorite city, Seattle, where I have so many friends. You acknowledge the contribution of everybody. So whether it is the uniqueness, because a lot of us Indians sometimes talk about other countries and cultures in a different perspective, but you chose to say, I learned a lot from them. We learned the methodology. We adapted it to this country. And the way you have weaved the spiritual search, the love for serving others, and also giving credit to everybody in the institution for the success is something which is so remarkable. And lastly, I really enjoyed the childlike learner in you. Even today, you are learning new things. You attend all our Thursday series because you are such a childlike learner. You have that curiosity to learn. And you know, as long as there is life, you keep on learning and evolving. So thank you very much, Shantiji. You have thank been you. Such a source of inspiration. Thank you very
thank
much.
You, Anil, and Hari Om.
Thank you very much. Thank you.